At the church.
Pentecost is a celebration of a new day dawning, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on all flesh, made possible through the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of our beloved Lord Jesus. This outpouring continues unto this day and forever. Through this outpouring, we, all of us, have been given the charge to be the voice for the voiceless, the rejected, the despised people in our community. For this reason, I, a priest and preacher with white privilege, have chosen to give voice to a woman born in India, now living in the U.S. Her name is Debbie Thomas, a lay theologian and writer. Debbie tells an amazing story of how the Holy Spirit worked within her and works within us, and how the Spirit equips us to fulfill the charge given us on that feast of Pentecost around 33 AD. So hold on to your seats. We're in for a ride. Debbie writes, "My native language is Malayalam, one of India's 200 official languages. Though my parents immigrated to the United States when I was an infant, they insisted that we speak Malayalam at home. So I grew up bilingual. I also grew up with a divided and defensive sense of identity. We, brown people, were Indian and spoke Malayalam, while they, white people, were American and spoke only English. As immigrants determined to make America our home, we might cross the great divide and master English too. But the linguistic traffic would never flow the opposite direction. After all, I had never met an American who heard of my language, in spite of the fact that 38 million people on this planet speak it. I must have been 9 or 10 years old when my aunt and uncle called our extended family together one weekend for a special surprise. When all 30 of us were gathered into his living room, my uncle introduced a guest, a blonde-haired, blue-eyed woman in her 30s named Sarah. He explained only that Sarah had spent a few childhood years in Delhi, where her parents worked as journalists, and that her family had vacationed occasionally in Kerala, the South Indian state my family is from. He then handed things over to her. It's hard to do justice to what happened next. Suffice it to say that 30 jaws crashed to the carpet when Sarah nodded to my uncle, smiled warmly, and said to us in Malayalam, and I'm not going to try to say what she said, "Hello, I'm so happy to meet all of you." Over the next 20 minutes, while my relatives gawked and gasped, Sarah told us her story in careful, convincing Malayalam. Bill's childhood trips to Kerala had fascinated her, so much so that she moved to South India after college and immersed herself in the language and culture. It was very hard, she admitted, learning the script, forming such new sounds, annoying people with my mistakes, but I am so glad I did it. Over dinner, she went on to explain how much her Kerala immersion changed her. "I did not realize before how limited my own experience and perceptions were. My ideas about humor, about art, about God. I didn't know how many things were unsayable in a single language." I thought about Sarah for a long time after that evening because her visit altered my world. Something had become possible for the first time. An alliance, a bridging, a new kind of empathy and friendship. when my family experienced the unprecedented pleasure of hearing an American speak our language, we realized that the many distances separating us from them were not, in fact, uncrossable. Hallelujah. Sarah, the stranger, had taken a risk, made herself vulnerable, entered our world. In doing so, she had rendered us less strange, less alien, less other. But she had offered us a challenge. It would no longer be possible in the light of her generosity to hang on to our stingy, self-protective narratives about identity. She had bulldozed her way through that barrier, and only a massive act of cowardice and denial on our part would re-erect it. This week we celebrate Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit by fire, wind, and word. Pentecost, from the Greek Pentecostos, meaning 50th, was a Jewish festival celebrating the spring harvest, the first fruits, and the revelation of the law at Mount Sinai. In the New Testament story, Luke tells, the Spirit descending on 120 believers in Jerusalem on the 50th day after Jesus' resurrection. The Spirit empowered them to testify to God's great deeds, emboldened the prophet Peter to preach to a bewildered crowd of Jewish skeptics, and drew 3,000 converts in one day. For Christians, Pentecost marks the birthday of the church. By any stretch of the imagination, it is a fabulous birth story full of riveting details, tongues of fire, rushing winds, accusations of drunkenness, mass baptism. It's easy to get lost in the spectacle, but the detail that stops me in my tracks every year is this one. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. At this sound, the crowd gathered together and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. As Christians, we take great stock in language, in words. Like our Jewish and Muslim brothers and sisters, we are the people of the book. We love the creation stories of Genesis, in which God bursts the very cosmos into existence by speaking. And God said, in the beginning was the Word, we read in John's dazzling poem about the incarnate Christ. On Sunday morning, we profess our faith in the language of liturgy, creed, prayer, and music. In short, we believe that language has power. Words make worlds and unmake them too. If this is true, then what does the miracle of Pentecost signify? Have we really grasped the importance of what the Spirit did, what the Spirit insists on at that inaugural moment of the church? After all, there's nothing easy about substituting one language for another. Languages are intricate and messy. They carry the full weight of their respective cultures, history, psychology, spirituality. To attempt one language as opposed to another is to make oneself a learner, a servant, a supplicant, to speak across barriers of race, ethnicity, gender, religion, culture, or politics, is to challenge stereotype and risk ridicule. It is a brave and disorienting act. And this is what the Holy Spirit required of Christ's frightened disciples on the birthday of the church. Essentially, stop huddling in what you call safety. Throw open your doors and windows. Feel the pressure of my hand against your back. Pour out yourselves into the streets you've come to fear and speak. Don't you understand? Silence is no longer possible. You are on fire. What I love about the Pentecost story is that it requires surrender and humility on both sides. Those who spoke had to brave languages far beyond their comfort zone. They had to risk vulnerability in the face of difference, and to do so with no guarantee of welcome. They had to trust that no matter how awkward, inadequate, or silly they felt, the words bubbling up inside of them, new words, strange words, scary words, were nonetheless essential words, words precisely ordained time and place they occupied. Meanwhile, the crowds who listened had to take risks as well. They had to suspend disbelief, drop their cherished defenses, and opt for wonder instead of contempt. They had to widen their circles and welcome strangers with accents into their midst. Not all of them managed it. Some sneered because they couldn't bear to be bewildered, to have their neat categories of belonging and exclusion explode in their faces. Instead, like their ancestors at Babel, who scattered at the first sign of difference, they retreated into the well-worn narrative of denial. Nothing new happening here. This isn't God. These are just blubbering idiots who've had too much to drink. But even in that atmosphere of suspicion and cynicism, some people spoke and some people listened. And into these astonishing exchanges, God breathed fresh life. Something happens when we speak each other's languages. We limit the limits. We experience the limits of our own words and perspectives. We learn how to understand the other person. And we learn we should have ordered her pages. Well, we do learn. Just a minute. What do we learn? What do we learn? We learn curiosity. We discover that God's great deeds are far too nuanced for a single tongue, a single fluency. I think the Pentecost story compels us because it's a story for our time. We live in a world where words have become toxic, where the languages of our cherished isms threaten to divide and destroy us. The troubles of our day are global, civilizational, catastrophic. If we don't learn the art of speaking across the borders that separate us, we will burn ourselves down to ash. For those of us living in America this election year, the temptation to retreat into our political enclave is especially strong. Why bother to understand, much less speak the languages of those whom we disagree with? Why not sneer? Isn't sneering easier? Isn't it more fun? Maybe. But it is no small thing that the Holy Spirit loosened tongues to break down barriers on the birthday of the church. In the face of difference, God compelled his people to engage. In the face of difference, God compelled his people to engage. Alleluia. From day one, the call was to press in, linger, listen, and speak. Because here's the thing. No matter how passionately I disagree with you, with your opinions, I can't disagree with your experience. Once I have learned to hear and speak your story in the words that matter most to you, then I have stakes I never had before. I can no longer flourish at your expense. I can no longer make you my other. I can no longer abandon you. And here I'm speaking. Here, my friends, is the key to civil, compassionate, spirit-filled speech. Once we have learned to hear and speak the other person's story in the words that matter most to them, then we have stakes we never had before. Imagine this. We can no longer flourish at the other person's expense. We can no longer make them our other. We can no longer abandon them. Debbie Thomas continues, in my church, we respond to Sunday morning scripture readings with these words. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Can we hear it? Can we dare to hear what the Spirit is saying? Stop huddling. Stop sneering. Listen to each other. Then speak. Silence is no longer possible. You are on fire. Amen.